Let's open our hearts to receive from what the Holy Spirit is saying to each one of us personally. Let's pray. Gracious Father, and just settle my heart before you. Lord, there is just no love like your love. There's no ending to it, Lord. Your love gives hope. Your love is joy. Your love is comfort. Your love is peace. And your love is infinite. There is not enough words to express your love, Lord. Lord, your love is tangible, approachable, filled with mystery. And even in your presence, Lord, we're enveloped in your love. Father God, our hearts opened up like a flower to your Son and receive your love, desiring to be nurtured in it by your Spirit. Firmly ground us, Lord, in your love, to know it deep in our inner being, the love of Jesus, and that we rest in it. Help us stand in the power and the might of your love. And Lord, we are filled with joy in your love. Your peace that flows like a river is because of your love, Lord. It's your love that has saved us. It's your love that keeps us. And it's your love that will carry us all the way home. Lord, we love you with all our hearts because you loved us first. And may this love that you have given us be poured out to others, Father, and you will be glorified. So, Father, I ask in the name of Jesus, by your Spirit, to anoint this time together. My words will be yours, and that you will be glorified. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Again, thank you for joining me here, and I've shared on a few points in the past few devotions, not really knowing for sure what the direction of the Holy Spirit was taking me, but these devotions seem to be leaning towards a learning of our kingdom authority. And this kingdom authority, I think sometimes we confuse it to be so spiritual that we have a hard time living it out. But of course, without the king, we have no authority. In looking at this with the Holy Spirit, I see this with a new vision. It's very interesting how the Holy Spirit's directing this. Well, so far, we've laid a foundation, kind of like a trail, really, of these devotions, just little nuggets, starting with why we needed to be born again, and just what occurred in that moment of our new birth. When we place our trust in Jesus, we're saved, given a new birth through what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross and his resurrection. And by the way, Christ is not Jesus' last name. I used to think that when I was younger, but actually it means the anointed one, the chosen one. In Hebrew, it means Messiah, Christ. This is his title. It signifies Jesus was sent from God to be a king and deliverer, Jesus Christ, Jesus the Messiah, the anointed one. So just to keep going, we've also learned how to walk with the Holy Spirit. We've learned about our thought life and how vital it is in the role of our spiritual growth. And we've learned a little bit about strongholds. And I believe the Holy Spirit will bring us back there in due time. But right now, we're going to keep going. And we've also learned how important it is to let the Holy Spirit have our thoughts and to control our thoughts, to govern our thoughts. And that is important for us to walk in obedience, in obedient trust and guidance with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit helps us take our human reasoning, which is our sinful nature, and help us crucify it daily. It's not easy because our flesh, really our sinful nature, is always an enemy to God. God is not looking for us to get better in our flesh. He's requiring us to die to our flesh daily, moment by moment. Like Paul said, there's nothing good that is in me, that is in my flesh. But we have a new flesh, hallelujah, in Christ Jesus. We are to take the old man off and put on the new. We're new creations in Christ Jesus. We're hidden in him. And our minds are in constant battle. They're in constant warfare. When we give our thoughts to the Holy Spirit, though, we are in a divine cooperative with Him to help us become more grounded in His truth. We learned our position in Christ Jesus and the empowerment of our walk with the Holy Spirit. We've also began looking at our position and the authority that we have in this position, kingdom, spiritual authority. It starts with the foundation, of course, with salvation in Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and operating in faith, the power in believing. This authority is not of ourselves. It's all encompassed in Christ Jesus. As believers, we're indwelt with the Holy Spirit. We're a conduit of His power and love as His children. We're His witness. Our authority comes from Him, and His love offered to us overflows to desire to share the good news with others. Even in this, it is through His authority. Jesus said in Matthew 28:18 through 20, He said, "All authority has been given to me in all heaven and earth. So go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I command you. And lo, I am with you always to the end of the age." With our lives as believers, we're under heavenly authority in submission to Him. Power resides in the person that is empowered by the Holy Spirit, Christ in us. Our position is of Christ and His authority, and He has given to us the gates, and the gates of hell cannot overtake it. He's given us this authority. So, we're under Jesus' authority, therefore in Jesus we have authority. This is our legal position, given to us in Christ Jesus when we were born again. We've been given kingdom authority by the King of Kings Himself. As children of God, we're now of His kingdom, His domain, and we must believe and trust that God is faithful, all-powerful, all-exceedingly above all that we can ask, think, or do. And it's for His glory. The power of His holy name is greater than we can ever imagine or think. But by faith we believe that He is able to do what He says He will do. This is faith that moves mountains. And as Jesus is, so are we in this world. 1 John 4:17. So if we are in Him, this authority is His, and we exercise it by faith. We've talked about the kingdom principles and the power of believing, trusting in His wisdom, His power, and faith in Him who is willing and able to direct our steps to empower us to overcome the evil one. It's like a childlike faith, God's faithfulness, that these battles are won. So salvation's our new position. Faith is the power in believing, and the divine cooperative of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit gives us all we need and the power to overcome. And in this position, we grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord as He reveals more of Himself, of who we are in Him, and how to walk this kingdom authority. These aren't full studies, but I pray that these little nuggets will draw you to want to know Jesus and to continue to build yourself up in truth with the Holy Spirit. If you missed any of these past broadcasts, I invite you to go back to the website of www.undergraceministries.com or the www.spreaker.com Under Grace Devotions. So I really am going to try to plow through this really quick because I only have a little bit of time. But this week, I'd like to continue on the path of kingdom authority and that we have in Jesus. So I was leaning toward the armor of God, but the Holy Spirit showed me a different way to go. He showed me the power of our authority is so much more, and certainly the armor is important, and I believe we're going to get there. But the Holy Spirit, I believe, is bringing me to the authority that is above all else. And it was really awesome to hear this in my own spirit. The power of love. His love is perfect. This is our kingdom authority. How is it our kingdom authority? Because we're under His authority and His banner of love. Song of Solomon's 2:4 says, love is who God is. Well, love is who God is, and God is love, and His love is mighty. His love in us reflects our King, His love reflects his power. It holds authority. We're under his banner, is what Song of Solomon is, verse 4, chapter 2. And in this, it holds authority. I just really see there's so much in that. Our salvation is out of his love. This is how we know that what love is Christ Jesus laid his life down for us. It's pure authority. 1 John 3:16, it's the power of his love. His perfect love could not hold Jesus. It's his love was so strong, death could not hold him. It could not keep him there. His love is so pure. His love was so holy. His love is so righteous. It's filled with grace, mercy, and truth. It's eternally glorious. His love is mighty to save. His love has positioned us from eternal damnation to eternal life with him. In this kingdom position of his love, we have kingdom authority. We begin to grow and experience this love. His love fills us with hope, and it never disappoints. It's poured in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, Romans 5:5. By the Holy Spirit also, this love produces fruit, the fruit of joy. Love produces peace and patience and kindness, and love produces goodness and faithfulness. His love produces gentleness and self-control, Galatians 5:22 and 23. The fruit of the Spirit brings life and peace and illuminates the kingdom and exhibits his authority, living the kingdom life on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus walked in this authority of love, and he revealed the Father who is love to us. 1 John 4:19 says, we love God because he loved us. Jesus loves everyone, all mankind. Children were drawn to him because of his love, because of his joy, because of his peace, of his very character. He was full of life, love, truth. So beautiful. Jesus knew his Father's love and is the exact representation of the Father. Hebrews 1:3 says, the Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. And because of his perfect love, we have no fear. There's no fear in love, but perfect love is cast out this fear. 1 John 4:18. So in this we know that our Father has not given us the spirit of fear. And Jesus, we have love, we have his power, and we have a sober mind. 2 Timothy 1:7. Again, in this is his kingdom authority. This is our position, our inheritance to receive and walk in it. His love is so powerful and authoritative that nothing can separate us from his love. Romans 8:35, verse 37 through 39 says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trial or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Verse 37, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Paul wrote, I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor heights or depths, or anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. God's love is the final authority. It's above all else, because it's the greatest love that God has given us. It causes our hearts to be bondservants to Christ, which means we follow our master. And that word master is a little out of our vocabulary, but it means that one who is in control, one who has ownership, the head of the household. So as bondservants to Christ, we're committed to him and completely disregard our own will. Jesus is the master of our hearts, the sovereign Lord, the owner of our hearts, for all who put their trust in him. That one is no longer their own, but bought and redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. So as bondservants to Christ, we lay down everything and commit our ways to follow him because of his great love. I'm convicted of this myself. I pray, Lord, less of me and more of you. Help me let go of my ways of thinking and seek your wisdom, Lord, and to discern by the Holy Spirit just what you would have me say, think, and do, to love him with all my heart. So when we obey him, we love him. John 14:24 says, "He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. And in this love is love, that we walk in obedience to his commands. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is to walk in love." 2 John 1:6. You know, Jesus intercedes on our behalf as well as the Holy Spirit to help us live this out, what he expects of us. His commands are not burdensome. 1 John 4:10 says, "In this love, not that we love God, but he loved us. And if we keep his commands, we'll abide in his love." Just as Jesus kept the Father's commandments and abided in the Father's love. These things Jesus spoke to us so that his joy would be in us and that our joy may be full. John 15:10-11. Our love for God is a reflection of his love for us. And he gives us this very thing, love, that he wants from us so we can love him. It says in Luke 10:27, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, all your mind, and love your neighbors as yourself." So when we love others as he loves us, we are loving the Lord. This is by his love in us. It is not being perfect, yet it is a dedication to follow God in all things, to be a vessel of his love, and to love as Christ loved. Kingdom authority operated in love. Operating in love is at the ultimate glory. Representing God in to others is our greatest witness. It's a selfless love. So Jesus said in John 13:34a, "A new commandment I give you, love one another as I have loved you." And Romans 12:9 says, "Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil and cling to what is good. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma." Ephesians 5:2. So, love reflects the kingdom even in our marriages. Husbands are called to love their wives as Jesus loved the church. Each man must love his wife as he has loved himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Ephesians 5:25-33. Do you see where the authority is here? It's the spiritual authority, and it operates from God's kingdom. God shows us what love is in 1 Corinthians 13. And I'm going to read this pretty fast. So it says, "If I speak with the tongues of men and the angels, but do not have love, I become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have faith that moves mountains and I do not have love, I have nothing. If I give all my possessions and feed the poor and I surrender my body and even to be burned, but I don't have love, it profits nothing." So love is patient. Love is kind, it's long-suffering, it does not envy, it's not boastful, it's not proud. So if we choose to love, to be vessels of his love, we can love patiently because Jesus is patient with us. We can love with kindness because Jesus is so very kind to us. We are long-suffering because Jesus is so very long-suffering. We don't have to be envious. We don't boast. We're not prideful. We honor each other. We're not self-seeking. We are not easily angered. We keep no records of wrong. And love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. We need Jesus to help us with this. Love always protects. Love always trusts. Love always hopes. Love always perseveres. Love never fails. This is by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit that we can only walk in this great love. Even to love our enemies, we're called to love them, to do good, to them, to lend to them, even without expecting anything back. Loving others in this way, there's rewards awaiting for you in heaven, and it reflects the Lord because of His kindness. His word is a love letter to us, and His love burns within our hearts. And just as His word endures forever, so does His love. In Jeremiah 31:3, it says, He loves us with an everlasting love. He said, I have drawn you with an unfailing kindness. And as we stay close to the Lord and abide in His love, we bear fruit and glorify the Father. John 15:8 and 9. Love is corrective because the Lord disciplines those who He loves. Proverbs 3:12 and Hebrews 12:6 says, Because the Lord disciplines the one He loves, He chastens everyone he accepts as His son. So as we've been learning what love is and how to operate in this command, we see in 1 Peter 4:8, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. But what does that really mean? It means love is forgiving. To cover sin is to forgive. And forgiveness is associated with love. The best example of love that covers sin is Jesus' sacrificial death on behalf for us on the cross. He forgave us. He bore our iniquities, and it's an undeniable act of love. In fact, Jesus did more than just cover our sins. He did away with them completely. Praise your Lord. This love is also protective, and it's an authoritative protection. He says, because He has loved me, I will rescue Him. I will protect Him, for He acknowledges my name. They will call upon me, and I will answer them, and I will be with them in trouble. I will deliver them and honor them with long life. I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Psalms 91. So to end today with this leaving with you, I want to, 1 Corinthians 13:13 says, Now these three remain. In faith, we have hope, and in this hope, we have His love, and the greatest of these is love. Kingdom authority, power in His love, to love the Lord your God, and to put on love which binds all things together in perfect unity. Let's pray. Thank you, gracious Father, for being love and perfect in so many ways, and it's unending and everlasting. Lord, when we're in your presence, we're touched by your love and we're undone. Lord, your love is relentless in pursuing, and we love you, Lord. Help us grow deeper in the knowledge of your love, and let it be deeply rooted within our inner being to know your perfect love. Refresh us, Lord, so we can experience you, and may our hearts be filled and committed to you. And thank you, Lord, for demonstrating such a great love for us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We bless you. We give all our adoration to you, and we thank you, Lord, and may you be glorified in all that we do. In Jesus' name.